Good morning, and can I welcome everyone to the 27th meeting of the Local Government and Communities Committee. Can I ask everyone to please ensure that all their mobile phones are in silent? And just a reminder that broadcasting will operate your camera and microphone as usual. Please allow a short pause before being called on to speak to allow them to do so. Today's main business is oral evidence and City Region deals, but first, item one, we have consideration of whether to take agenda items 3 and 4 in private. Item 3 is consideration of the evidence received in City Region deals. Item 4 is consideration of a draft letter to the Scottish Government on pre-budget scrutiny 2021-22. As we're meeting remotely, rather than asking whether everyone agrees, I will instead ask if anyone objects. If there is silence, I will assume you're content. Does anyone object? In that case, I will take that as acceptance and that is agreed. Items 3 and 4 will be taken in private. Agenda item 2, the committee is taking evidence in City Region deals, a policy area where we have watched closely since undertaking our inquiry in 2017. And I'd like to welcome to today's meeting Michael Matheson, Cabinet Secretary for Transport, Infrastructure and Connectivity, the Scottish Government, and Ian Stewart, Parliamentary Under-Secretary of State, Scotland Office, the UK Government. This session is an opportunity for an update on progress on deals and how both administrations are working together to make these deals a success in these challenging times. Both ministers are also joined by the following supporting officials who may or may not be called upon to speak today: John Pixton, Deputy Director, and Leslie Jackson, City Deals Policy Manager, Regional Economic Development Division, Scottish Government; Neil McLennan, Head of City Deals and Local Government; and Rebecca Hackett, Deputy Director of Policy Division, Office of the Secretary of State for Scotland, UK Government. I'm grateful to you all for taking time to answer our questions today, and thanks also for your written updates, which are included in our meeting papers. For your information, we've allocated up to an hour and a half for this session. We'll now move on to brief opening statements and questions in a moment after some technical information in relation to the handling of questions. For the benefit of broadcasting, there's a pre-arranged order and I will call each member in turn to ask their questions for a block of up to 9 minutes. It would also help broadcasting if members could indicate who on the panel their questions are addressed to. We may have a short amount of time for supplementary questions at the end if they're required. For those on the panel, please indicate clearly if you wish to answer the question, for instance by raising your hands, which I'm able to see on my monitor, and don't feel the need to answer every question if your views are in line with points already made. So could I please ask everyone to give broadcasting staff a second to operate your microphones before you speak? And Mr. Matheson, would you please go ahead with your opening remarks?
Good morning, Convener, and thank you for your invitation to join the committee this morning. I covered several key points in my letter to the committee last week, and I won't repeat them here. Rather, I want to take this opportunity to reiterate the three key principles underpinning the deals, which inform our whole approach to delivering what is an important programme. Firstly, inclusive growth. The deals themselves cannot deliver a more inclusive Scotland on their own. However, our overriding focus is ensuring each and every investment benefits local businesses and communities, helping our regional economies become more inclusive and sustainable in the long term. Secondly, partnership. This is a complex, wide-ranging and long-term programme. The key to its success now and in the years to come is the strength of the relationships we have built with regional partners right across Scotland. As in any partnership, we will face challenges at times, not least COVID-19, and we'll do so again in the future. However, our ability to overcome these is a testament to the commitment of all involved to the successful delivery of this programme. And finally, regional empowerment. The deals are locally developed and led. Government has a role in ensuring investments deliver against key national priorities like inclusive growth, but it's regional partners who take the key decisions across this programme. And of course, Convener, I'm happy to respond to any questions that the committee may have. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. Mr. Stewart, would you please go ahead with your opening remarks?
And good morning, and thank you too for this invitation to address the committee and to take questions. Like Cabinet Secretary Matheson, I won't just read through all of the letter that I sent you. I'm sure that's been shared with the members, but just to highlight a couple of key points. Firstly, I'm delighted that we now have deals in place right across Scotland, with the most recent ones, the quantums being set for both Falkirk and the Islands. And each of the deals is at a different stage, with the earlier ones starting to produce some very clear dividends. And I'll happily take questions on each of the individual ones as members wish. I would also just say I've been in post now for 5 months, and this has been a very good example of where all levels of government, UK government, Scottish government and local authorities can work very well together with other key stakeholders in the public and private sectors and with academia. And I think this is a very exciting range of initiatives to help secure the long-term development and innovation in Scotland. And with that, I'll pause and very much look forward to having the discussion with yourself and your members today.
Okay, thank you very much for that. I'll start off the questions by asking yourselves and Mr. Matheson, 6 years after Scotland's first deal, and there's now potentially 12 Scottish deals, but less than half are live at this stage, could either of you provide a time commitment on when all deals will be finalised and active?
Well, Convener, I think you're right to say that we are at a point where there's a number of the deals that are already in delivery phase. It's fair to say of the £1.9 billion that we've committed to all of the deals across the country, but £1.3 billion of that funding is already part of the deals which are actively being implemented. I'm keen to, not only was I keen to make sure that we had deals across every part of Scotland, I'm also keen to make sure that we see the remaining deals which are at heads of terms progress to becoming full deals, and those where quantums have been agreed, that we progress them to heads of terms as quickly as possible. My view is that the existing deals that need to be finalised and progressed to heads of terms could be completed by the end of this financial year, and I'm committed to pursuing that timeline, which would allow us to make sure that all of the deals continue to make progress over the course of the next couple of months, and to arrive at finalisation of all of the deals at some point in the middle of next year.
Mr. Stewart, do you have any comment on that?
Well, just to, it might be helpful if I give you a short overview of the next milestones that are coming up. Later this month, on the 19th, we have a date in to sign the full deal for Ayrshire, and that will hopefully be followed very swiftly by the full deal for Tay Cities. We hope to reach the head of terms with Argyll and Bute towards the end of this calendar year, with heads of terms for Falkirk and the Islands, and the full deal for Borderlands early next year, and the full deal for Moray over next summer. So the later ones in the programme, we have a clear agenda for getting those progressed as quickly as possible.
So both of you then seem confident that it will be done by the end of the financial year, but are there any specific challenges preventing the progress of the deals that are still in development? I know the obvious one is that COVID must have put the mockers on it to some extent, but is there any other challenges that you're facing? Mr. Yes. Matheson?
Okay, I wasn't sure who Convener wanted to respond to that. Can I say that there's a couple of different issues that do have an impact on timeline. COVID has had a bit of an impact, but not a significant impact on taking forward preparation of some of the deals. One of the points that we've been keen to impress on deal partners is they need to make sure that when they are developing their proposals, is that the details of their business case are as thought through and contain as much detail as possible, because that allows us to carry out an assessment of them in a much more timely fashion and to provide feedback in a much more timely fashion. But we've continued to engage directly with the programme management officers to provide them feedback on areas where we believe further work needs to be taken forward on any outstanding deals or aspects of deals. And by and large, most of the partners respond to that engagement very well. So the work that's carried out by our partners, particularly local authority level, has an impact on the timeline, and the greater level of detail they can provide us with in terms of business cases, then the better and the quicker we can make progress on that. The other aspect I would say that there are some aspects around individual deals. Minister Stewart may want to say a bit more around the Tay Cities deal. We were hoping to sign the Tay Cities deal last week to take it to a final deal. I know there are some issues for the UK government to pursue around this matter, but it's important that we try to make as quick progress on the Tay City deal as possible. And I've recently written to my colleague in the UK government just to try and clarify timelines around this issue. But I think if there's one thing I would say that it does have a bearing on timelines, it can be the detail, or in some cases not sufficient detail for us to make decisions around matters, and we pursue that with the partners at a regional level to try and get the necessary information to allow us to make decisions in these matters.
Thank you very much. And Mr. Stewart, would you like to comment on the Tay Cities deal and anything else that you feel appropriate?
Certainly, and firstly, just I concur with much of what Mr. Matheson's just said about the importance of the partners bringing forward properly developed business cases, because quite rightly, both governments have a proper audit and a scrutiny process to go through to check that the deals are sound. And our officials will work very closely with the partners to help them do that. Secondly, just on COVID, at the start of the pandemic and subsequently, we have been in touch with them to see if there are particular issues. For example, if constructions had to be paused or delayed because of the restrictions. Our general view is that while there's been, some minor changes that have been made, for example, allowing some deals to their drawdown of funds to happen at different intervals, those have been satisfactorily resolved, but we haven't seen a general wish to completely, change the programmes or introduce new programmes. Finally, on Tay Cities, yes, we are ready to go with signing it on the original terms, but what we're trying to accommodate is the request from various partners to have the UK government's funding over a shorter time period. And I'm currently in negotiations with the Treasury to see if we can get that agreed. If that's not going to be possible, we are ready to sign on the original terms and revisit the reprofiling issue subsequently. But it's a short delay, literally a matter of a few weeks, to see if we can get that compression of timelines agreed first. Which I think would be a helpful development. So the delay is for a good reason, not a problematic one.
Okay, appreciate that. Thank you very much. I've got one more question, which I think is probably more for you, Mr. Matheson. It's the Scottish Minister's committed to at least matching deals funding from the UK government. Audit Scotland believes there's a risk that this could result in the Scottish government providing more financial support to a deal than it otherwise would. Would you say that this is a financially prudent approach, or have you found that that's not the case?
No, we've taken a very measured approach with the deals. I'm conscious that there are very often the bids very often exceed the financial envelope that's available for individual deals, which will obviously leave some partners disappointed that not all of the proposals that they've brought forward can be met through the deal. However, we've taken a very prudent approach that we've invested a level of funding in what are long-term deals to reflect what we believe is the appropriate level of investment for the Scottish Government. And we've matched the UK Government in all of the deals that have been agreed and taken forward to date. So the level of investment we are making is reflective of what the Scottish Government believes is the appropriate amount for us to invest and is within our funding profile over what is a long-term deal. Many of these deals are, you know, for 10 years, some go beyond the 10-year period, and that's taken into account in our budgeting. So I believe that we've taken an appropriate approach to the quantums which have been allocated for the deals.
Can I ask, just before I finish, when you get something like that in the report from Audit Scotland, would you respond to them in terms of saying that you don't agree with the findings?
Yeah, we tend to the Audit Scotland report was a rather strange report in that it only looked at the Scottish Government element of the deals because it couldn't look at the UK Government element of the deals, and that was reflected in the report itself because they don't cover the UK Government. So it was a bit of a one-sided report in that sense. However, we responded to the issues which were raised within it, and if I recall correctly, the Director General Liz Ditchburn wrote to the PAPOS committee setting out a response to these matters. I don't know whether John Pinkston or Leslie Jackson want to say a bit more about that, but we did respond to the issues which were raised within the actual Audit Scotland report itself to PAPOS.
Okay. Would anybody like to join?
I think this is one for Leslie, so Karina.
Leslie.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, just to reiterate the Cabinet Secretary's point, we did, Liz Ditchburn did write to PAPLs in April setting out a response to the Audit Scotland inquiry. I don't think there was anything that we fundamentally disagreed with in the recommendations they put forward there. They were very helpful, and we've certainly gone away and reflected on them, obviously, taking into account the Cabinet Secretary's point about it being very much focused on the Scottish Government half of the programme.
Right. Okay, thank you very much for that. I now ask Sarah Boyack to ask a question, please.
Thank you, Convener. I'm very interested in raising questions that we've had from those who've given us evidence about the extent to which the deals are aligned with existing policy and ensuring that you've got cross-policy connections that are made. So I'm thinking of the National Planning Framework, the work done by the Infrastructure Commission, last year's Climate Change Act, and just seeing how these are dealt with through the delivery of city deals and the planning for city deals, because the evidence we've had to the Parliament suggests that alignment is not working yet. So, first of all, if I could ask Michael Matheson to answer that question.
So, Convener, some of the deals and the signing of the deals predate some aspects of the National Planning Framework, including the publication of the report from the Infrastructure Commission. So there are aspects in the legacy deals which predate these the updated National Planning Framework and also the Infrastructure Commission and also the Climate Change Plan. What I can say to Sarah Boyack is that one of the things that we do when we receive proposals for a deal is that the different directorates within the Scottish Government and different ministers within the Scottish Government will give consideration to the proposals that are brought forward by regional partners in their portfolio area to consider whether they align with national policy and wider policy around areas such as the National Planning Framework and also aspects relating to the Infrastructure Commission report. So we do try to make sure that when we are evaluating proposals that are brought forward for deals, is that we give consideration as to how they are aligning with broader national policy. Having said that, it is important for us to remember that these deals are largely driven by regional partners, and they will all have a varying degree of difference in them, reflecting the different competing needs in different parts of the country. But I can assure the member that we do look at seeing how the proposals align with their broader national policy, and also to try and reflect on the fact that they are an approach which has been taken trying to reflect the needs of the local regional economy, and to try and balance that out. So they may not always align perfectly, but broadly they should actually fit in with their broader national approach.
Okay, thank you. Does Mr. Stewart have any comments he wants to make about that policy focus?
Thank you. I broadly agree with Mr. Matheson that the genesis of the projects comes up from the local level, and we do look at how those fit into very general broad public policy objectives, and I think particularly for the later ones they do. For example, on the net zero ambitions, a lot of the sort of later deals have some very exciting projects on reducing carbon emissions and other climate change related projects. So I think there's, as Mr. Matheson said, there may not be a perfect alignment, but a lot of the work, and these projects are by their very nature long term, do sit quite well with the broad policy objectives of both governments.
Thank you. And one of the things to follow on from that question is actually how you track those different levels of decision making. We've had some pretty critical comments from certain stakeholders about the transparency of the decision making process and the effectiveness of it. And both ministers have talked about changes that have taken place over time, reviews, and different outcomes from what might have been started at the start of the process. One of the striking comments was the SDUC, who commented that the decision-making structures were opaque and undemocratic. And just listening to both of you talking about the changes, timelines, I'm just wondering what your comments are about that, because there was a range of comments from people that were quite critical about the process. Mr. Stewart, you're still on my screen. I don't know if you want to start.
Thank you. Well, each of the deals has different review points in it. Some of those will differ depending on the nature of the deal, but there'll be annual reports and conversations to make sure that the deals are being administered properly. But I would also say that in the genesis of the projects, there are widespread engagement with local stakeholders, and I would point particularly to the Angus part of Tay Cities as an exemplar of that, where the specific proposals that were developed came up from that very broad engagement with those local partners. And of course, local government too has an important scrutiny role in the genesis and administration of the projects.
Thank you. And Michael Matheson, do you want to come in on that issue about accountability and transparency?
Yeah, I would. I agree with the points that have been made by Ian Stewart on this matter. I think it's also worth highlighting that deals will have a deal committee that's responsible for oversight and taking forward the deal at a local level. That's by and large made up of elected members, local elected members within our local authorities, and therefore there's a very clear line of democratic accountability in how some of the deals are progressed, given the way in which local authority councils are engaged in that process. The other point I would make as well is that if you and Ian Stewart made reference to aspects of the Tay Cities deal in Angus. If you look at deals such as Ayrshire, there was a very extensive public consultation exercise in looking at what the key issues would be for any deal in Ayrshire. There was a similar process in Borderlands, where there was a consultation exercise and looking at a wide range of priorities. So I think it's important to acknowledge the process that many of our regional partners are using in order to try and identify what the priorities are for them in their deals. And that's helped to inform the finalised deal package. And alongside that, the role that democratically elected local councils have in progressing and taking forward the deal once it's been finalised, which is very often a process that's conducted in an open forum, and also the minutes, I believe, of the meetings are published for public scrutiny.
Thanks. Mr. Matheson, just a quick... Sorry, is that all right, Convener? But when we get to the deals actually being implemented, will there be outcomes monitored? So, for example, Mr. Stewart mentioned zero carbon ambitions. You've talked about national planning framework. Will there be a checklist that people can see what's been delivered, whether it's jobs, reducing our carbon emissions, and impacting on our local economies and impacting on businesses?
Yeah, one of the pieces of work which we've been taking forward recently is around the development of a benefits realisation plan, where partners are able to demonstrate the extent and nature of the impact that their plans and their deals are having. So in terms of jobs and in terms of delivering inclusive economic growth, we've been taking that work forward in partnership with the Edinburgh and the South East Scotland deal partners who are piloting that process. That is now at a very advanced stage where we're now looking to roll that out to other deals. So I think it'd be fair to say there has been, and if I recall correctly, this was a point that was highlighted in the Audit Scotland report, there is a need for us to make sure that our partners are assessing and evaluating the impact that their deal is having on their regional economy, and that they can demonstrate that more openly. And the benefits realisation plan is a process that can assist us in doing that. And once we've completed the guidance, we'll be expecting all of our deal partners to take forward a benefits realisation plan and to report on that on a regular basis, alongside the annual report that they have to publish for each of their deals to demonstrate the progress that they're making and the impact that it's having as well.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister and Cabinet Secretary. These city deals have been a breath of fresh air in many communities. It was the opportunity for the coming together of both governments to ensure that they unlocked investment, they created jobs, and they gave some hope to some communities who had felt that maybe they had been left behind in the past. And that has invigorated and given these communities the opportunity to develop and move forward. So I think that the whole idea behind it has been well received. But as we've already discussed this morning, there have been log jams, there have been blockages in timelines and heads of terms. And in the past, I, as a member of this committee, have been communicated by council group leaders in Stirling and Clackmannan and across the Tay City deal, which fall into my region of Mid Scotland and Fife, to try and engage to see why there were some of these problems. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, these have continued to happen in some areas, Cabinet Secretary, where there is these log jams and there is these opportunities, and there has been a bit of frustration on local government and also on the part of some of the partners as to how the engagement is. And as Ms. Boyack already has asked this morning, the transparency and the scrutiny and the governance has been questioned. So if I can ask Mr. Madison to maybe develop on that and then move on to Mr. Stewart.
Let me pick up on a couple of the points which have been raised by Alexander Stewart. In terms of the Tay Cities deal that you made reference to, in terms of the timeline there, we've been ready to sign that deal for a considerable period of time now. And I think it'd be fair to say that, as Ian Stewart has already referenced, he is in discussions with the Treasury to see if he can move that from a 15-year deal to a 10-year deal, which is what is presently holding up the signing of that and that deal and it becoming a finalised deal. So that's a matter which Ian Stewart can give you more detail around. It's also worth saying, in terms of the Stirling and Clark Manager deal, as well, some of the they've recently met some challenges which have resulted as of COVID-19 and it has presented them with some financial challenges around the profile that they had planned for that deal. We've been in very detailed discussions with them around that in order to look at what amendment could be made in order to try and help to unblock that particular logjam which they're facing as a result of that. We have offered additional financial flexibility. So, for example, the way in which the money can be drawn down, to be able to draw it down on a more frequent basis in order to give them a greater level of flexibility. So what I would say is that we try to respond to issues of concern that may be raised by partners where they are experiencing difficulty. Does that mean that it is government that's causing the difficulty? It's not always the case. It may often be that the difficulty is being caused for as a result of issues out with our control. But what we can try to do is respond constructively to trying to help them, to try and assist in addressing the blockage or difficulty that they may be experiencing. If I could say that in some of the deals where there have been issues of making progress in getting the deal from a quantum to heads of term or from heads of term to final deal, sometimes the issue is around the detail and the business case being put forward by the proposal. And there is, in some cases, a need for our partners to provide a greater level of detail so that we as a government can have a clear line of sight about what the ultimate outcome of any proposal may actually be, and that we can have the level of assurance that we are looking for that the project can actually be delivered. So there's a variety of different factors, because it's a complex landscape, as you rightly point out, that can all have an impact on causing particular difficulties. But the partnership, in my view, across both governments and with regional partners, is a very strong one and is very much committed to trying to address any issues that may arise at whichever level within the deal process.
Thank you. Yes, I think Mr. Matheson's right. You know, a lot of the issues are to do with the issues within the business cases, and he rightly points out that we have a very collaborative and interventionist approach to help resolve these. There are also other events that happen that weren't initially expected when the proposals were put forward. For example, there was, in terms of broadband rollout, there was legal challenge in the R100 programme, which had an impact on the Highland, Inverness and Highlands deal. So, you know, these things will come. You know, that's public life. You know, these unexpected events can happen, but I think we've got a strong partnership to help resolve those or unblock them as possible. And the other point I'd make, just going back to the Tay Cities deal, and this also illustrates the importance of having strong business cases from the partners. Within the Tay Cities deal, we have been able to progress and accelerate the Eden campus project near St Andrews. Because that business case was well developed, it got through the approval process for both UK and Scottish governments, and it's now at the place where it can start drawing down funds and get it going. So, you know, you know, we do have a good program timeline generally, but where there are opportunities to accelerate, we take them. And if there are problems that try and hold things up, we intervene as quickly and constructively as we can to help resolve them.
Thank you. That is a good explanation of where we are and how we are progressing. The whole idea of funding, I'd like to just touch on now, because when these programmes and projects come together, a funding package is agreed as to what will be going into those city deals in these regions. And it was very much of a level playing field when it started. But that has seemed to have changed as we've gone forward. The UK government put in their sum, but then at times the Scottish government increased that from their side. And can I ask Mr. Matheson, why was that done and why has that been a focus for the Scottish government to fund slightly higher or slightly more across some of these regional deals? And the publicity that generated put the Scottish government in sometimes quite a good light in comparison to the UK government. And I'd like to know the sort of understanding behind that and that process.
Well, you won't be surprised to hear, Mr. Stewart, that one of the jobs of a minister within a government is to try and actually do the right thing and to make the right decisions for a regional economy when it comes to these types of deals. There are a couple of deals. So, for example, there are four deals all in where we have of the deals that have been agreed, or where we're at heads of terms, or where we are at a quantum level where we put in additional funding. And the reason for that is because we actually believe that the deal deserves a greater level of funding. You could turn your whole question on its head and you could ask, why has the UK government not matched that additional level of investment that's been made by the Scottish government? But clearly, that may be your next question. So it's not for me to put questions in your mouth, Mr. Stewart, of course, but it's what it is a reflection of is that when we have assessed individual deals, there have been deals where we have recognised that there are proposals in areas that we believe require investment. So, for example, if I take, for example, aspects of the Falkirk deal, which has been agreed at quantum, one of the key areas that the Falkirk deal proposed was around looking at tackling some of the issues that they have around Grangemouth and the petrochemical plant, and also the wider industrial facilities within the Grangemouth area, to look at what they could do to invest in order to reduce the carbon output. We see Grangemouth as being a critical part of Scotland's industrial base, and decarbonising of that area is a priority for us. And therefore, additional investment was agreed from the Scottish Government to help to support that type of decarbonisation. And we're now working with partners in Falkirk to look at what would be the best way in which to use the resource that we've been able to allocate in addition to our overall deal funding in order to achieve that objective. And likewise, when it comes to areas such as Aberdeen, where there was a significant level of additional investment provided, a key part of that is investment improving rail connectivity between the northeast of Scotland and the central belt in order to reduce the time that it takes for trains to get from Aberdeen to Edinburgh and Glasgow. And part of that additional £254 million of investment in the Aberdeenshire deal is to help to support that type of work in helping to improve rail connectivity for the whole variety of reasons that I'm sure the member will be well aware of, that comes from greater and better rail connectivity. Some of these are additional amounts that have been allocated specifically in order to support measures that, from the Scottish Government's point of view, we see as being extremely valuable. And for that reason, we've put in this additional investment to support regional partners in driving forward these changes within their local area.
Okay, right.
Thank you very much.
You're well over your time, mate, sorry. Keith Brown.
Thanks, convener. Just to take up the theme the deputy convener started with about accountability and transparency, and in particular in relation to the one in my local area, Stirling and Clackmannanshire, and just to point out it's Clackmannanshire to Xander Stewart, it's the county rather than the town of Clackmannan, it's a partner in this. But just to say that was a very unusual deal because for the first time the UK government did not allocate a number of or funding towards a number of projects, but instead allocated a quantum in relation to Clackmannanshire of £8 million and then asked the authority to come up with projects within a year, which he then did and waited a couple of years. I just wonder, given what Mr Stewart has said about the accountability in Angus and the transparency, will the Clackmannanshire projects, the Clackmannanshire part of the Stirling-Clackmannanshire deal, be able to demonstrate transparency in which projects are actually supported? And will that reflect the priorities put forward by all the local partners in Clackmannanshire, including the Commission, on which the local authority, which, if you go back to the origins of city deals, are meant to be the driving forces in this? So will it reflect local priorities, and what will be the level of transparency for that £8 million?
Well, the any bid that comes... sorry?
On you go, Mr Stewart.
Sorry. The first point is that any project bids that come forward will have the usual requirement for a full business case that has to go through the usual channels and will be subject to the scrutiny and accountability process for any authority, for any deal. But my, must forgive me, because a lot of this work predated my appointment, but my understanding is that initially the Clackmannanshire didn't put forward any projects in the first iteration of this deal, and it was all largely centred at the Stirling side. And we were very keen that these deals do cover the broad geographic area of each deal. So that's why my understanding is, and my officials who were there at the time when I wasn't may wish to comment, but you know, it is going through the correct processes, and any bids will be assessed in the normal way.
Mr. Matheson, for Ricky.
Sorry, convener, Keith Brown does raise an important issue, obviously given his previous ministerial role in dealing with deals previously. The original process for taking forward deals was a process which was for proposals and business cases to be developed and then for governments to consider that and then to agree a quantum which would then be allocated based upon the business cases that have been outlined by regional partners. That process changed a couple of years ago where it was largely, my understanding is, and Minister Stewart will be able to say a bit more about this if need be, but my understanding was that the change in approach was driven by the Treasury and it was a decision that we should go to a process that was, or the UK government wanted to go to a process where the quantum was agreed and then the projects would be considered as within the quantum being agreed first. So it was a change in the process that was which came about as a result of a change, as I understand, from the Treasury's approach to these matters, which does mean that we now agree the quantum before we agree on what the projects may actually be, which was a fundamental shift on the way in which previous deals prior to that change had been agreed.
Keith. Convener, thanks. Just one other point on the point raised by Alexander Stewart about the overall funding. We're regularly told in Scotland that the UK government has variously broad shoulders, deep pockets, but we're more concerned that they've got short arms. So we've seen in relation to some of the funding, Stirling Club Manager is a good case in point. The UK government, as it gets close to a deal, cutting the quantum available. Now, I have no problem at all if the UK government wants to look good by putting more in. I just wonder why, when we started off with that £500 million each, for example, in the Glasgow city deal, why the UK government's moved away from that matching funding with the Scottish government. Has there been a reason for that? Is there a financial constraint, or is there some other policy decision that underlies that?
Mr. Stewart?
Well, the point I would make, on the deals themselves, there is match funding between the Scottish and UK governments. The point that's been made in previous questions and answers is that you do have sometimes additional funding that sits alongside the particular deals to augment the impact and opportunities that each deal has. And some of those will be from Scottish government, but equally there can be investment from the UK government. And I would point to a couple of potential examples on that. For example, in Mr. Matheson's own area in Falkirk, their bids at a very early stage, but one of the likely projects is centred on decarbonising bus technology that Alexander Dennis will be closely involved in. Now, the UK government is, again, this is at an early stage, but with its Green Bus Fund, that potentially could involve some additional investment that would sit alongside that. In the borders, in the Borderlands deal, one of the elements is a feasibility study for extending the Borders Railway from Tweedbank down to Carlisle. Now, if that gets the green light, if you pardon the railway analogy, through the UK government's connectivity review, that could involve additional investment that would sit alongside the city deals. I appreciate those are both hypothetical examples, we're not there, but that's why you sometimes get side investments from both Scottish and UK governments that can help complement the deals which do have match funding from both governments.
Keith? Sorry, Keith?
Thank you.
Right, thank you very much.
That's me, Kavina, thanks very much, yep.
Right, thank you. Andy Whiteman, please.
Thanks very much. Indeed, Convener. I just want to ask a question about an area that's caused a little bit of confusion in the past. The UK government, as I understand it, has stated that it will only fund projects that are in the reserved space, that are not devolved, although I understand there's been some flexibility around that. I wonder, Mr. Stewart, if you could clarify that just now, and if you could comment on any justification for such a policy, given that the city deals are designed to deliver economic stimulus over a long period of time, and those benefits will be, you know, accrue to various aspects of the devolved reserved space over time, regardless of perhaps the particular definition that was applied at the beginning.
Sure.
You're broadly right that, you know, UK government will invest in reserved areas and Scottish government in devolved areas. But I think it's a sign of maturity that if partners ask for a particular funding for a project, then we give due regard to that. And I regard all investment as welcome. And if we're able to facilitate that, I think that's a good thing. So if we're boosting, for example, tourism or culture that's of broad benefit to the Scottish economy, particularly as we bounce back from the COVID period, I think that's all to be welcome.
Okay, and I wonder, Mr. Matheson, you have any comment on this matter, especially in light of the fact that there's some nervousness about signals from the UK government that in future it may spend directly in Scotland in devolved areas. Separate debate, but that there have been signs of that. This is an example of where this, the UK government may well be doing that. Are you comfortable with the way in which the reserved and devolved competencies sit within city deals?
Broadly, I would say yes to the latter point that you make in terms of how they work through in terms of deals. I think it's important to recognise that the Scottish Government regularly invest in areas which are matters of reserve policy. A very good example of that would be in digital connectivity. So, for example, the DSSB programme and the R100 programme are all areas of devolved competence, but we've had to step in and make very significant investment in these areas. So we tend to prioritise our investments on the basis of what we believe is the right investment on the basis of the case that's put forward by regional partners, rather than strictly looking at it on whether it's a reserved area or a devolved area. But by and large, the way in which it breaks down is that it falls into those areas when the final projects are funded. If it helps in terms of my understanding of this, though, is that my understanding is that part of the reservation on the part of the UK government in investing in areas around deals which are within devolved competence goes back to a concern that was raised by the Treasury, which was around this idea that they were investing greater levels of funding in Scotland in areas that had already been funded through, technically, through the block grant that's given to the Scottish Government. So it was this idea of we're double investing in areas that's already considered for within the budget allocation that goes to the Scottish Government. And I think that was part of the background to the concerns that you're raising, and that was that the Treasury didn't want to be seen to be investing an even greater level of investment in areas of devolved competence that was already provided for in the Scottish Government's budget. On your wider issue around the UK government, which is not specifically in these deals, around the idea of it starting to encroach into areas of devolved competence, that raises very fundamental issues about the devolved settlement and the process that we go through to determine the types of investment we make in Scotland. Let me give you a practical example of that. On transport connectivity, the UK government have set up that connectivity review without any consultation with us whatsoever that wants to look at transport. Now, we go through a very, very rigid, very clear dynamic process called the Strategic Transport Projects Review process that engages local communities, local partners to identify what our priorities are. If we then get to a position where the process that we've developed in Scotland is completely ignored and pushed aside in order to allow some sort of review that the UK government has set up to just override the democratic processes we have here in Scotland, that's completely unacceptable and can't be tolerated. That's a clear power grab, and that's a fundamental undermining of the democratic process that we have here in Scotland and a devolved settlement, and shouldn't be tolerated. So your wider point, I have very serious concerns about some of the provisions within the Internal Market Bill around infrastructure and how the UK government are seeking to encroach into areas of devolved competence that could have a fundamental impact on our decision making around some key aspects of infrastructure investment that could potentially have an impact on some of the deals that may be impacted as a result of any process that the UK government tried to use to go over the heads of the Scottish government.
Okay, that's helpful. Amanda, we won't continue the debate in that area. I just wanted to draw the contrast, and I suppose if one were to take a positive message out of this, the work that's being done on city deals is helpful, at least in identifying a better understanding of the balance between reserve and devolved competence, and how, particularly if the UK government is intending to make direct investments, how the process by which that might best be facilitated. If I can move on, a question about accountability. If, for example, 5 years down the line, and of course one wishes this weren't to happen, but if a project went seriously wrong, who would actually be accountable for that? Because it appears to me that obviously the people on the ground who are delivering it may be accountable. It may be found that there wasn't proper diligence or scrutiny at either the Scottish Government level or the UK Government level. Normally, matters of accountability in the expenditure of public money by the UK Government, by the Scottish Government, by local authorities is relatively straightforward. But in this case, you've got a mix of funders, a mix of levels of government who have had a stake and a role in approving it and financing it. Can you say anything about what thought's been given to how we deal with the question of accountability if things were to go wrong? Perhaps I'll start with Mr. Matheson because he's on my screen.
So I think you raise an important issue, and I think it reflects the complex nature of the way in which deals operate and the way in which they are taken forward. And given that they are long-term investment programmes, they carry risk with them because the time at which you make the decision on what your priority is, the circumstances could change, which means that the deal needs to flex and you need to adapt it to reflect those new the new and changing environment which you're operating, which again can bring risk with it itself. On the issue of accountability, I think we are in a culture where we like to have a individual as being accountable. The reality is that given the way in which deals operate, is that there could be a number of different people who are accountable for it. It could be me as a Scottish Government Minister, if it's decisions that we have made or a lack of oversight on our part on how an aspect of a deal has been taken forward, which is a failure internally within the Scottish Government and potentially the UK Government on the issue. Or it could be that it's a failure on the basis of information that was not provided to us by regional partners to highlight there were problems with it that we weren't aware of or that information wasn't shared with us as well. So the reality is it could be a variety. It could be regional partners and governments, or it could be one or the other. What I would say to the member though is that we have a process which we believe gives us a level of oversight with partners to identify where there are risks emerging with particular projects and to understand what those risks may be at an early stage in order to look at what mitigation can be taken forward in order to try to manage that or reduce that particular risk. So the sort of early warning system that we have is a way that helps us to try and identify where problems may be starting to emerge to see what early action can be taken. And I receive reports on a regular basis from my officials on any areas where there are problems that are emerging and the engagement we're having with regional partners to understand what those problems are and what actions they're looking to take to try and help to deal with them. So I suppose it's not a clear answer in terms of it will be me, but it could be my responsibility, but it could be a shared responsibility with our regional partners. But we do have a system in place that allows us to try and help to keep track of deals and the progress that's been made with projects and where issues are arising to intervene early in order to try and address any issues of concern.
Okay, thank you, Convener. I think my time's up, but if Mr. Stewart just wants to add anything to that, I'd
have the opportunity. Thank you. Very briefly, you know, I think the short answer is, as Mr. Matheson has alluded to, that in effect all of us have a responsibility. In a very strict technical sense, the Scottish Government has the accountable officer role. The way the funding works is the UK Government share of the money is transferred to the Scottish Government, and then the various deals draw down from that. But you know, that doesn't absolve any the rest of the partners from responsibility. And as we've talked previously, there are a whole range of reports and early interventions that can take place. And it's also, I think, just my final point would be that although the quantums of city deals are equally finance from Scotland, Scottish Government and UK Government, individual projects within it might have a different balance. So, for example, the Eden Campus project is very largely UK funded, and other projects will be largely Scottish Government funded. So the process that we go through in terms of approving the business case is very important as part of that overall process. It's a complex picture, but I hope we, between us, it's a good example of us jointly working we've demonstrated a good system of oversight on these deals.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stewart. Thank you, Andy. Gail.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning and welcome to our panel and guests. City region deals are indeed very welcome, and my line of questioning is actually more about the distribution rather than the funding itself. I want to talk about, well, in particular, it pertains to the Inverness City Region deal, and I want to know about the weighting between the city and the region, because the city could claim that anything that happens in the city benefits the region, and the region could well dispute this. So is that up to local partners to, I was going to say fight amongst themselves about, but I mean, obviously decide themselves in a local capacity, or is that part of the overall terms of agreement? Either or.
Shall I start on that one? Thank you. Well, I mean, it's, this is an example of where, you know, the bids come up from the local level, and it is largely down to the local partners, Highland Council, particularly in your area, to bring forward the proposal. So it's, while we are keen, and the answer I gave to Keith Brown earlier demonstrated this, we are keen to see a good coverage across a geographic area for the bids. We are really responding to what comes up from the local level. That's the genesis of the ideas. It's not us saying, we think this is a good idea, off you go. So it, again, it predates my appointment, but my understanding is we provided what the local partners in Highlands wanted. So I fear that's more of a debate to be had with you and your colleagues in that part of Scotland.
Yes, indeed it might be. I don't know, Michael, if you've got anything to add.
I recognise the point that you're making and the concern you're expressing, and I agree with Ian Stewart, is that the projects that are taken forward in a deal or proposed for a deal come from local partners rather than being directed by us. And different local authorities have engaged in different processes for identifying what those projects may actually be. So as I mentioned earlier on in response to a question, is that if you look at deals such as Ayrshire, they've used a community engagement process to help to inform the priorities that they have set out in their deal. Similarly, Borderlands have had a lot of local engagement with stakeholders to identify what their priorities would be. And it's important that all of the local authorities, when they are taking forward deals, are having that wide-ranging engagement with stakeholders. One point I would make, though, is that if Highland Council were to bring forward a proposal, a deal, if just say they didn't have a deal just now, but they were to bring forward a proposal to us that centred only on Inverness, you would rightly expect us to challenge that. And I think, in fairness, they haven't done that. If you look at a range of the projects that they have within the Highland deal, for example, the Science Skills Academy, the Fit Homes project, and also the Affordable Homes project that they're taking forward, they are spread across the Highland Council area, including into areas such as Caithness, that I know would be a priority area for yourself. So we would rightly challenge any proposals that came forward for a deal that was very centred on a single population centre. But I think, in fairness to the Highland Council deal, it is one that is covering a range of different parts of the Highland Council area, including into Caithness.
Thank you. That leads me quite nicely into my second question. We talked about, we touched upon earlier about, I suppose, reallocation of funding in terms of COVID. But what would happen if, just for example's sake, again, Highland Council came to you with a proposal to reallocate funds for a project that was just emerging that hadn't been considered as part of the terms of the agreement? Would it depend on what that project was? How favourably would you look upon that? Michael, sorry, Cabinet Secretary, I'm being very informal, apologies.
So, as I mentioned earlier on, Convener, because these deals are long-term investment programmes, it's important that we do allow a level of flexibility to reflect changing circumstances. And some of the engagement we've been having with deal partners recently has been around the challenges which they're facing with COVID-19, how that's impacting in some of the projects that they're intending to take forward, to see whether we can offer flexibility or adapt potentially some of the projects that they have been looking to take forward to reflect the changing environment which they are operating. So we're having flexibility around that in terms of being able to draw down funding on a more regular basis. And in some cases, as Ian Stewart alluded to with the Eden project, to actually draw down funding ahead of the full deal being signed, given the very detailed business case has been put forward. There have been instances where some partners have asked for flexibility around how some of this funding profile could be used and how they could front load some projects and run a longer timeline for other projects. So what I would say to remember is that we're always open to engaging with partners to understand what any new emerging issues may be, to look at whether it's something that we can offer some flexibility around the deal in taking forward. There will be times, as has been the case, where we've said to deal partners that's not possible because it would involve additional funding or it's not something that would sit within the deal. But we're always open to engaging with partners to try and help to pick up on issues that may be emerging in their area to offer some flexibility, including new issues that may be emerging, and to look at how we can help to work flexibly with them in addressing any issues that may be arising that we can reasonably accommodate within the overall deal process. But the member will also recognise that they have to, that anything like that would involve all of the deal partners. So where it spans more than one local authority area, that they would have to be involved in that process to consider any reprofiling of funding to help support other matters that they're looking to take forward within their area.
Okay, thank you. And just in my final minute, there's a group now in the north of Scotland, in my constituency in particular, made up of Highland Food and Drink Club, North Highland Initiative, and other business people. And the Highland Food and Drink Club gave us some written evidence that said that they believe that city deals are, and I quote, being abused and more governance is required to achieve the best result for the area. Changes required to ensure industry is consulted openly and not just a select few, a plan drawn up, industry involvement. So they're obviously feeling a wee bit left out from the whole process, and they've come up with an idea about a North Highland growth deal. Is that something that might be considered over and above the city region deal if these communities essentially feel left out of the current process? Maybe go to Ian Stewart first on this one.
Thank you. And firstly, can I just say I very much agree with what Michael Matheson said about the flexibilities that are there, in response particularly to COVID. I think I'm right in saying that at the outset we did approach all the local areas to say, what are the likely impacts and are there any new schemes that they would envisage? And my understanding is that they didn't come back with any new schemes. There were some asks on some technical details on on reprofiling the drawdown of money and so on. So we have that flexibility. In terms of doing a new deal, I think that would be a long way off. We have heard, it's on our radar, the particular issue that Gail Ross mentions, but it's, you know, we have it on our radar and we will obviously look into it. But I don't think, you know, it'd be very problematic suddenly to tear up an existing deal that was in response to local, you know, partners' requests, and suddenly swap it into something else. You know, there'll be all potentially all sorts of contractual difficulties with that. But I'll certainly, if we can come back to you on the specifics of that case that, that you've raised with us.
Thank you.
Okay. Right. Annie Wills.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. I just want to touch on the sort of a Glasgow city deal. I mean, it's the oldest one. It's now in its sixth year, and I just wondered if there was any examples of where it's starting to deliver. I wonder if anyone can give me just a couple of examples of where we've seen the city deal working well for Glasgow. That's to both.
Okay. Can you, off you go, Michael.
Thanks. Annie Wells may be aware that the structure for the Glasgow City deal is a different structure to that of the other deals in Scotland. It's a deal which has been framed very similar to the deals that were put in place for the cities in the north of England back in 2013-14. Period, and therefore the responsibility for choosing, developing and delivering projects in the Glasgow City deal is somewhat different. Some practical examples would be the parts of the Avenue project, for example, in Tucky Hall Street have been part supported through the City deal funding that has been provided. The work that's taking place, for example, around the Clydeside regeneration work, which has helped to attract in Barclays to develop their new office space on the south side of the river, has come about through some of the regeneration work that the Glasgow City Deal partners were taking forward. You will be aware, though, of course, that the City Deal goes way beyond that of just Glasgow City Council. It goes into Renfrewshire and into Lanarkshire as well, and also up into Dumbartonshire. So there's a variety of different local authorities that are involved in the Glasgow City Region deal that goes beyond Glasgow City itself. But that's a couple of practical examples within Glasgow City itself where it has helped to generate some benefit, in particular helping to support the attraction of Barclays' new office that's it's now pretty advanced the last time I passed it. For their new office space in Scotland.
I don't know if Ian Stewart would like to comment on any of the sort of successes we've seen.
Certainly. Well, I mean, two very recent ones are, and I appreciate this is the sort of greater Glasgow area too, rather than Glasgow City itself, but obviously has a, you know, huge impact across the region. The first would be the Glasgow Airport investment area, which is, you know, that is now well advanced, and similarly the regeneration and the transport links round about Ravenscraig in the Motherwell area, I think are two very exciting developments, and that sits alongside, you know, the new business centre, which offers a much more flexible office space. Facility. I understand that's pretty much full now. And linking that back to earlier comments about how these city deals can help the sort of post-COVID recovery, you know, the demand for those sort of flexibility, that flexible office space is in high demand, as opposed to, you know, more rigid commercial premises. So I think, you know, that the fact that we're able to provide that at an early stage in the deal, you know, shows the, you know, the great benefits that these investments can make for regenerating the economy in the years ahead. So I think Glasgow area deal is a very exciting one, and looking forward to seeing it, more fruits of it appearing in the months and years ahead.
Thank you very much for that. And in my previous role in committees, I was on the Equalities and Human Rights Committee. So I want to just touch on the equalities and to ask what extent are there adequate processes to support and account for equalities and sustainability in planned outcomes and impacts? I don't know, Mr. Stewart, if you want to answer that first.
Well, my understanding is, like any other bid for government investment, it has to be accompanied by a full equalities impact statement. My officials will correct me if I'm wrong in that, but that's my understanding, that has very much to be taken into account. And on a sort of the longer term sustainability point, as I mentioned in response to earlier questions, particularly for the later deals, we are seeing, the sort of longer term environmental green investments being a central feature of many of these deals, which links into our broader net zero ambitions. So it's very, very central to the genesis of these bids and the approval of them that they do, meet all these important criteria.
Mr. Matheson, have you got anything to add?
Yeah, if I just add to that, because one of the issues that we were challenged on as part of the work that was carried out by the Equalities and Human Rights Commission was to be able to demonstrate the inclusive nature of the benefits that were coming from projects within our city deals and city region deals, and in order to strengthen our ability to support partners ensuring that they're delivering inclusive economic growth, we now have a member of staff from the Equalities and Human Rights Commission that's embedded within the deal process at the Scottish Government, that works with regional partners to ensure that they, as they take forward the deals and the projects within deals, is that they are looking at issues around equalities and they are being built into the process and mechanism that they have for taking forward these projects. So given that we were challenged on that issue, we now have a process that is much more robust and one which also facilitates access to very specific specialist advice and support that's been provided to deal partners, the system in doing that, and I've got no doubt that will have benefit in helping to deal with some of the equalities issues that Annie Wells is making reference to.
I've got time for one final question, Convener. It's just really a general question as to, as the City Deals programme is an example of the two governments and the three tiers of local government working well together. And is there an example of that that we could look at? Just, I don't know if that's something that Mr. Stewart maybe may want to answer.
Thank you. Yeah, I think that the general answer to your point is yes. In the course of the last 90 minutes or so, Michael Matheson and I have been agreeing with each other in a lot of our answers. I came to this my role about 5 months ago, and it's been very refreshing to see that there is this very strong partnership, not just between us and the Scottish Government, but also with local authorities and their partners. It's a very positive and constructive engagement. I think is a good model, and inevitably there are bumps in the road and issues to be resolved, but those are tackled with a cordial and constructive approach. So I think there are lots of projects that I could highlight. One that we've mentioned already, the Eden Campus project, which is now getting going, it's also going to be I understand, involved in the Michelin Centre in Park in Dundee with some of its hydrogen work. So there are, you know, that's not entirely within the City Deal programme, but is an excellent example of how the City Deals can help link into other investment and development projects in Scotland. So it's one of the more pleasurable bits of my portfolio to work on City Deals, and I very much look forward to continuing that constructive engagement in the months and years ahead.
Mr. Matheson, have you anything to add?
I would say that, you know, very similar to what Ian Stewart has just said there, is that we have a collaborative fashion. We openly engage with one another around the issues relating to individual deals, assessing deals as well. There's a good strong relationship there in taking these matters forward. I think one of the strengths of the way in which we've taken forward deals is that they are taken forward between the governments and our partners in a mutually respectful way, that we engage with each other, and that all parties within it are treated on an equal basis. So there's no imposition from the Scottish Government or the UK Government on one or the other, or imposition from Scottish and UK Government on local authorities. We try to do it in a collaborative fashion. And I think that's probably one of the key lessons from the deals, is that if you want to look at how you can help to support a positive working relationships across different spans of government, it's got to be done in a mutually respectful way, and it's got to be done in a fashion which recognises the different roles that each layer of government actually has, and to respect their responsibilities. And that's why I think the way in which we've been able to take forward the deals in recent times has been a successful way in which that type of approach can be made to work effectively.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you, Annie. That completes our questions and concludes this evidence session. I'd really like to thank Mr. Matheson, Mr. Stewart and the panel for taking part in this meeting, and for identifying some key issues for the committee scrutiny of this important policy area. You can leave by the meeting by clicking on the red telephone icon, and once again, thank you for your time this morning. That concludes the public part of this meeting, and we will resume the meeting in private on Microsoft Teams. I propose we resume the meeting in private in 5 minutes. Please accept the clerk's meeting request for the private discussion, which will be sent shortly. You can exit the meeting by clicking on the red telephone icon, and I now suspend.